Lots of unprivileged things like which were kind of not so oxygen-y. But there were lovely things. And one of the real privileges was to, when you'd be at a deathbed and helping humanoids to leave the earth. And it was an incredible privilege. There's no place like a deathbed, except a birthbed. And in a certain way, the deathbed is a kind of birthbed. Henry James, the wonderful American novelist, said that nothing makes a person feel so alive as to witness another die. Elias Canetti, the Austrian Jewish writer, said, "The reason we're happy at funerals is because they're not our own," which is kind of cool. But the thing about helping someone to die is that usually people are so surprised that was it. And the loveliest place to be is if you're helping someone to die who has really lived their life. Jesus, it's a great place to be. One time I was helping a bandito to die, a kind of roguer, a bochel. He wasn't sinister like, but he really was wild. And he was old. And I had done all the magic with him, put the sins whistling, and I had put on the holy oils and everything in him. And then it was time for off. So I said to him, "I've done everything I can do for you now, and you're on your way. And you've just a little while." And he said, "Yeah." And I said, "What would you say about the whole thing now that you're about to leave it?" And this big roguish smile crossed his visage. And he said, "By Jesus," he said, "I knocked a hell of a squeeze out of it." And the next thing, in 2 minutes, he was gone. And I was saying to myself, as the Americans say, what a way to go. Like to say that I knocked a great embrace and squeeze and hug out of my life. And I've seen other people die. And I have seen their deathbed being a place of the most tragic, lonesome, forsaken regret. People who never lived the life that they desired. Postponed it, allowed themselves to be beset and contained by other people's expectations and their own anxieties and uncertainties. And always were waiting for a future time to enter their lives and inhabit them, and never did. And suddenly it was the evening of their death, and their sad, lonesome eyes looked back on a life that they had squandered. I learned this from somebody's. When you dream, when you wake in the morning, when the clock goes off or whatever, don't open your eyes first. Keep your eyes closed and try and just get the tail end of the dream. And then if you just get two fingers on it, you'll pull most of the thing back and then just note it down. The Talmud says that a dream that is not interpreted is like a letter that has not been opened. And you know, if you're sending yourself these letters every night, it's kind of only courtesy to call around sometime and to kind of pick them up. Because you will, if you keep an account of your dreams, get a great sense of who you are and what's happening. And like in folk traditions, especially the Indian tradition in America, they really charted their future according to the symbols that came in the dreams. So you're day two, still tired after the big move. My second birthday, my age has doubled in a year. If this keeps up, I'll be 90 by the time I'm 6. Stephen Wright, I really recommend him. He's the best comedian. Like another thing he says, "We've just put a new skylight in our apartment. It's driving the people upstairs crazy." And I just leave you one last one with him. He says, "I'm having the experience of amnesia and deja vu together. I think I've forgotten this before." But, so you've all these possibilities as a child. I think very soon after we hit the canvas of the earth, we get a very fast read, a survival read on where we've landed. What the other creatures, the bigger creatures are like, and what we need to do. So, say as a baby you were confronted with 6 possibilities and you chose number 1. Then when you were in childhood, about seven, you were confronted with three possibilities. This time you chose two. Say, in the middle of adolescence, when you were in the hormone forest, and it was very Einstein, space, time, everything, and querying, this, and you were confronted with two possibilities. This time you took the first one. Say then, when you were 20 and you met somebody that you really fell in love with, you had five possibilities, this time you took four. When you were 40, you had three, this time you took number three, da da da. So all the time, the person that you are here this evening is a result of key choices that you made on thresholds that you've probably now forgotten. And you chose along the way until you chose your way into this life now. And that's why you're who you are. But the interesting question in relation to possibility to ask is, what happened to the other lives that you never chose? Where are they? I think this is a really fascinating question. And I have an old suspicion that life isn't just, that time isn't just linear, but that it's also a spiral thing. And I feel that the lives that we never chose actually move along with us. And maybe that's the secret of when we die, is that we only finally get to leave the world when these forgotten lives have also somehow realized themselves. I love that line in John's, I better say a couple of holy things, seeing that you're all holy people. But it's true, Jesus, when I hear the hymns, I was there thinking of imagination, I listened to all these hymns, and I said, get holy. But to say a holy thing, one of the lines that I've always loved in the New Testament is in John's letter, where he says, one day you will know as you are now known. And that's a very cool sentence. Because it means that right now you are being known by God. And that that knowing is always accompanying you. And that one day, when you cross the old threshold and go into the death thing, you'll meet that knowing coming towards you that'll say, Jesus, how you, John? And you look at the knowing and you'll say, God, you're my knowing. You're the knowing the way I was known. And then you'll suddenly realize that even the most profound knowing that you had of yourself was just a little wisp in the wind compared to the knowing that the divine has of you. And like I was saying, that God is the great imagination. And I think that's true. And I think we're made in the image of likeness of God, which means we're meant to create as well. So to put it like, to sum up what I've been saying, it's like this. Every time you're creative, you're on holy ground. Because you're actually deepening, extending, and realizing creation. And that's where I think the beauty of God comes in. I think that there is a wonderful danger in God that we have totally forgotten. Because one of the things that humanoids like to do is they like to bring in the tamers, the theology tamers, to tame their deities down. They don't like the idea of a wild God, because it could get very awkward and deeply embarrassing. So the respectability of theology, confession, all the rest of it comes in and makes the God nice and palatable. The colors are inevitably pastels. The music is nice and low, like the schlocky music that you hear in supermarkets. And that could be just the odd little beep when you realize, God, there is a God somewhere out there behind the whole thing. And one of the reasons that so-called young people, which are a strange kind of species anyway, are leaving religion is that because God has died for them. Or become incredibly boring and uninteresting. And I think that one of the tasks of our time, for those who are interested in God, is to make God dangerous again. And the best person I know who does that is the fellow I was talking about in Oxford this morning, is Meister Eckhart, the 13th, 14th century mystic. He is unbelievable, just unbelievable. And I'll end up by just telling you a couple of things about him. One thing he said is, Nothing in the universe resembles God so much as silence. Nothing in the universe resembles God so much as silence. Then he says, God is that wilderness in which each one is alone. He also says, and this is lovely about yourself, you know, I think one of the greatest gifts that anyone can have is a contented heart. I think no one else can give it to you. But you can have all the world has to give. But if you're not contented in your heart, it's only tormenting you and making you completely kind of miserable. And there is, I believe you don't have to get a peaceful mind or a contented heart. I think there is a native tranquility within each of us that's already there. And through quieting your mind and your heart, you can slip right down into it. But one of the things, like in Ireland, when you'd ask somebody a question, you'd rarely get a straight answer. Do you know that kind of way? Be going around a bit, around, like you were saying. You know, how are you doing? I'm not too bad. How are you? Irish, I was often worse. Then it kind of goes, no information has been communicated. It's true, like, we're experts at this. Dancing. But, like, when I went to America first giving talks, Jesus.